He was the lowest-ranked ROC player in the men's singles at these Olympics, but buoyed by his best result of the season at Wimbledon, Karen Khachanov has battled his way into the final in Tokyo, winning 3-3 setters before an emphatic display in the semifinals. His opponent is a good mate in Germany's Alexander Zverev. The world number 5 pulled off a huge upset in the semifinals, ending the 22-match winning streak of Novak Djokovic. His big serve has been working the entire week. Based on his ranking and the career accomplishments, Zverev starts as the favorite, but he has lost his last two outings against Khachanov. Welcome along, indeed, to this men's singles final on day 9 of the Olympic tennis event. And just like the previous 8 days, it is hot and muggy, some of the toughest conditions these players have ever played in. Alison Hughes, a very experienced chair umpire from GB. She'll be directing the traffic in the chair. Hawkeye is in use at the Ariake Tennis Coliseum. He was so emotional after that victory over Djokovic in the last four, weeping in celebration. And for Khachanov as well, now has his eyes set on winning the gold. A man who's also beaten Djokovic a couple of years ago, indoors at the Paris Masters. A day off for both these players following the semifinals. He seems to be in good spirits, Khachanov. And a reminder, this final is a best of three sets. First time in a men's Olympic final, it will be best of three, not best of five. He has been playing so well this entire week, Khachanov, just like Zverev. And indeed, having won the last two contests against Zverev, this draw featured the world number one in Novak Djokovic after winning the first three majors of the campaign. He was going for the calendar year Golden Slam. So my question to you is, how surprised are we to have these two in the final?
I think you can make a case for both being here in the final, certainly pre-week, but yeah, very surprised at the start of the week we wouldn't have been talking about these two, particularly the man in your picture, Karen Khachanov, because really, if you wind the clock back about a couple of months ago, just before the French Open, this guy was really struggling. He was having a bit of a wretched year. I was actually fortunate enough to commentate on his match against Cam Norrie, and just confidence looked so low. He was mistiming the ball. And, you know, he relies so much on confidence because he's a front foot player, big ball striker, and when it's slightly off, it means that he can be very off. But yet, he's got into a bit of a rhythm. You mentioned his success at Wimbledon coming in. And I think the fact that, you know, no one really fancied him here, so that's fantastic. And then, as you mentioned, Zverev beating Djokovic, that was a big upset. But was it the biggest upset? I would say perhaps no, because, you know, at some point, Djokovic has got to show us he's human. He was just going and going and going. And here's a guy who's beaten all the best guys in the business in the best of three set matches. And he's beaten Djokovic twice before. But to do it here on the big stage, it was a phenomenal performance.
Indeed. Phenomenal performance by Zverev, who was down a set and a break in that semifinal before really elevating his game at one stretch, winning 8 consecutive games. Now, look at his run to get to the final, only dropping just the one set. You keep an eye sometimes on the double faults of Zverev. He has struggled with that over the years, but he has really limited the double faults while slamming down these big serves. The victory against Basilashvili, one stage of the match, he had 7 consecutive love holds. So that tells you how well he is hitting.
Certainly does. I mean, if you look at his statistics in his last two matches as well, first serve percentage against Shardy in the quarterfinals, 74% against Djokovic, 72% first serve percentage, and he's winning so many points behind it. It was decent as well with the second serve, which has been much talked about. He only hit one double fault against Djokovic, won 9 out of 19 points, which I think he'll take that stat going into today. But it has been an issue in the past, of course. Previously, against Khachanov, as in a number of double faults in their last meeting, 8 in total. He only won 32% of points behind the second serve against Khachanov when he last met him in Montreal in 2018. And his last really big final, okay, he's been in Masters finals, but his really big final was the US Open. And there he struggled, didn't he? He hit 15 double faults and only won 41% of the second serve. So with all of these matches, because it's a fairly quick court, the serve is vital, especially with these two. They're front foot players. That big strike, that first strike will be absolutely vital. And you just wonder whether Zverev's serve will hold up. As in that match actually against Khachanov, he actually had a decent first serve percentage, but the second serve really struggled. So even if he has a decent first serve percentage, will that second serve hold up? So far this week, it has held up brilliantly.
It certainly has. Yeah, under that pressure of trying to close it out against Djokovic, no issues whatsoever. And how about this day off between the semis and the final? He has all this momentum after beating Djokovic. Is it a good thing or can it be a negative?
I think it's a good thing for Zverev. I mean, watching him on court, you know, he was pretty much crying on court, sat there. He said it himself, it's one of the biggest wins of his career. And, you know, playing for his nation as well, all of those things that are wrapped up with the Olympic Games, which means so much to tennis players. I think the fact that he could just digest that win, and I probably think he would have needed the morning off. And so I think it's probably helped him. He knows he's playing well. And the same goes for Khachanov. We've got to remember as well, I mean, yes, he's won a Masters event before, won in Paris a couple of years ago, but that was still one of his biggest wins of his career. And I thought he was excellent in terms of how he got over the line. Didn't show that the nerves, dealt with those nerves superbly well. And so even for him as well, just to have that day off, just to calm yourself down, get yourself ready. So I hope they're both fresh. It's been really tough as well with the heat. We've seen it take a lot out of players. And I actually think that's one of the reasons why we're seeing Khachanov in the final, because he's such a physical specimen. He's been able to deal with that heat, I think, a lot better than others. And so I think both will be fresh. I don't think there'll be fatigue that is an issue in this one. But it's going to be really exciting. Who can deal with the nerves and the pressure?
And we hope so. We hope it's going to be a good one between Zverev and Khachanov. This men's final at the Olympics is about to begin. Alexander Zverev, the world number 5, facing Karen Khachanov in the Russian Olympic Committee. Number 25 in the world has been inside the top 10. The winner will succeed Andy Murray, Sir Andy Murray, as the Olympic champion in the men's singles.
About Zverev's serve in the build-up, but that has been a key factor for Khachanov, how well he has served. I mean, his first serve statistics have been staggering. Won 26 of 28 points against Pablo Carreño Busta in the semi-final.
Great defending by Zverev. For such a tall player, especially, he moves so well around the court.
Yeah, I just mentioned that Khachanov serve. Zverev with those long levers, 6'6", so he's one of the best returners in the sport. and he will want to get into those types of rallies. He'll look to try and pick on the backhand side of Khachanov. So that'll be a nice little confidence-boosting start into a nice rhythm already.
Six-foot-six, or 1.98 meters, and his older brother, Misha, who's former player, now his manager, was saying after the win over Djokovic, he feels like he's 2.2 meters going to this final.
Yeah, you can understand that. And as you were just saying, isn't one of the reasons why he's one of the best players on tour is because of that movement with his frame. Of course, a lot of credit has to go to Jez Green over the years, what he's done with the German.
Doing the dictating, as he likes to do with the forehand, Khachanov.
It's a heavy strike, isn't it? That's something else we've been talking about with regards to the court. Another thing that suited this man's game is that it's receptive to spin. And he's got a very extreme grip on that forehand side, so he hits a heavy ball. It really kicks up off this surface. Of course, he can hit big as well, so everything's really suited to his game.
Including the serve. A nice, confident start for Khachanov.
And it's funny, isn't it? As in, I mentioned earlier during the warm-up, as in, just where Khachanov was a couple of months ago, as in, he was at his lowest point, really, for about 4 or 5 years, just in terms of his confidence, in terms of trying to win back-to-back matches. And it's a sport like no other because it's individual, it's so psychological. But suddenly, he just started to put a few wins together and the confidence started to flow back, and then reaching the quarterfinals of Wimbledon, and then clearly that gave him the boost that he needed coming into the Olympic Games.
Ace number 51 this week for Zverev. He's played just over 11 sets. 3 double faults only. And you're talking about Khachanov, what he did at Wimbledon, how things can change quickly. He would end up losing in 5 to Denis Shapovalov, who was up 2-1 in sets. But his previous match was an absolute crazy one against Sebi Korda. Wrong-footed there, expecting down the line from Zverev.
And we talk about confidence and building confidence. I mentioned that he lost to Cam Norrie in Lyon, Khachanov. And for me, that was actually a turning point for him, that tournament, because that was in the semi-finals. He picked up a couple of really scrappy wins in the first couple of rounds there. Went into that tournament having lost 4 matches in a row on clay, and that's a surface that he's, you know, played a lot of course, being based in Barcelona for much of his youth. And so I think the fact that he just found ways to win matches when not playing his best tennis, okay, then it took a little while. He was tight and played a good match actually against Nishikori at the French Open, but I think just by fighting through a couple of those matches when you're not playing well, suddenly the belief comes back a bit. And it's all about working hard, and he certainly works hard. And
great work ethic.
Yeah, superb. And that then was what I think delivered that win over Seb Korda, 10-8 in that fifth.
Well, that was interesting because in the fifth set, it was 10-8. There were 13 breaks in the fifth set. Never happened before. The most breaks in a set at Wimbledon in men's singles. And he was broken 6 times, but he actually got one more break. Some context, he's been broken 5 times this whole tournament. He's been doing a fair bit of that. Zverev really elevating that part of his game when he faced Djokovic middle of the second set onward. That's when he really stepped on the gas.
The two shots you always focus on with Zverev with regards to how he's playing. The backhand's always money, but it's the forehand and the second serve in particular, and the forehand has been fizzing all week.
And that is terrific. And while you mentioned the forehand, both these players can have the big forehand. Sometimes they can just go away for a little bit. Is that safe to say?
Yep, I would agree with that. And I think that was one of the struggles with Khachanov when I was talking about just something little going wrong, but such an extreme grip he has on that forehand side and such a fast racket head follow through. So the margin of error is smaller for him, similar to Zverev, although Zverev's not as extreme on his grip, but his follow through and how he faces the racket face towards the ground very late means that it's very quick, so things can go wrong with it if the timing's just off. But what it also means is that when they connect, it's hard, it's fast, and it's heavy. So that's why that on their day, they're some of the best forehands you can witness. But when they're slightly off, we can see a lot of unforced errors.
And sometimes he gets into a habit of hanging back behind the baseline.
And he's quite upright when he hits the forehand, Zverev in particular.
Well, flirted with danger on that second serve, but then missing the backhand. And the first break point of this final going to Zverev. First blow administered by Zverev in this final. Forehand was working, ground game working. And it's the German who leads 2-1.
Well, what a start by Sasha Zverev. We were mentioning the forehand, but that is looking so good so early on. Said the second point of the match for me was actually a significant point of the match because he got a good return in off a first serve from Khachanov, and then he was able to hang with the Russian at the back of the court. And you can see here, he's the one who's getting up the court, getting closer to the baseline. And as you were saying earlier on, he does have a tendency sometimes to back away when he's feeling tight, but so far he's in full flow, Zverev, and when he's like this, he can often be unstoppable. So really bright start from the German.
Yeah, the Davis Cup captain, Michael Coleman, was saying in the training camp ahead of the Olympics that he looked like Zverev was on a mission after what happened at Wimbledon. His last match there, he lost to Felix Auger-Aliassime, 20 double faults. So he's really tidied up that part of his game. Karen Khachanov, 25 years of age to match his ranking. Born in Moscow, now spends most of his time in Dubai. Good training base for a lot of the players. Zverev trying to consolidate, serving it 2-1.
flag was moving too much in the breeze, so wanting to sort that one out.
Such a great kick on that second serve, but missing the backhand. We were chatting during the break, in case you weren't with us, about the double faults and how in his match at Wimbledon, where he lost to Felix Auger-Aliassime, 20 double faults. That is so nicely done. Took on the backhand down the line.
I was thinking tactically how Zverev would approach this match, and I wondered whether he would actually try and come forward a little more. He's got a bit more variety to his game than Khachanov. So far, I think his coaching team and family will be absolutely delighted with the way he's approaching this match. Real positivity.
Right time to play it, because Khachanov was expecting the big drive, and again the forehand, so nice from Zverev.
Well, of course he played the US Open final last year, and there would have been some demons from that performance, a match that I think many thought he could have won. It was a very tight finish to that encounter, so we're wondering how he was going to deal with the pressure of a gold medal matchup, but it looks like he's just taken to it.
Well, another example.
I mean, this is just stunning. Someone needs to tell him he's in a gold medal match here. I mean, this is some of the best tennis I've seen Zverev play. And he's doing it on the big stage. He's got those long levers. And when he takes a full swing at that forehand, he can really do some damage. Wonderful angle.
He does consolidate for 3-1. Serving like he has done just through the entire week. There were a couple of costly double faults in that final set tiebreak against Dominic Thiem. And why do you think over the course of the last couple of years there has been some fluctuation on that second serve?
Well, and I think fluctuation tends to suggest it's a mental thing more than anything else. I mean, we talk about golf and yips, and I think he's talked about having yips on his serve a little bit, de-accelerating, so then not having the confidence to follow through as he should do, or in terms of get the racket at speed as you need to. Which is so crucial for the second serve, because in tennis, you need to swing faster to get the control, which is quite a strange thing to have in your mind.
Because otherwise you can get into a habit sometimes of pushing.
Yep, and it happens to all levels of players. And it's such a unique sport in that way, because to get the generate the topspin, you need to swing through faster. And I just think it's been a case that he's lost confidence with it, and then he has tried to push. And then as soon as he starts to be too careful, then he decelerates and loses complete control of the ball. So that's why we've seen him divvy from hitting two first serves sometimes, just to deal with that, which is getting himself into that mentality of getting up and hitting through the ball. But that, I think, is why sometimes he just feels comfortable and he feels good. And if he doesn't hit double faults early on in matches, he feels settled. And that's why it does fluctuate. There were issues as well, possibly with the ball toss being too high as well, if you're looking at it technically. But there's been no real issues here, has there? So it is amazing, isn't it, that the last match he plays before he gets here, and we're talking about the double faults again, gets here and he's served just amazingly well.
And this is shades of what happened last year at the ATP Cup. He was hitting double faults aplenty, but then did some work before the Australian Open, and they totally vanished as he made the semifinals. Oh! He's having a closer look, Zverev.
But again, this is another point for me that just shows you Khachanov's got to work a little harder to win these points than his previous couple of rounds. You know, against Carreño Busta and against Humbert, those forehands would have probably been winners or at least drawn errors. But Zverev, his court coverage is magnificent. Those long levers, he makes Khachanov play that one extra ball. And there it could have got tricky, couldn't it, had the net court not gone Zverev's way, or not gone Khachanov's way, I should have said.
Good sign there also for Khachanov, two very slow balls. He had to generate his own power, which wasn't an issue, but also those slower balls can cause some issues on the forehand side. Timing. He wasn't sure when he left his racket. 14-30. That was a fairly important game for Khachanov, given the way that Zverev has started this final. Is able to get the hold, keeps it close in the first set. Zverev on top, 3-2. First Olympic experience for Sasha Zverev. He didn't play in Rio in 2016. Just having some fitness issues at the moment and pulled out as a precaution. Also first appearance for Khachanov. He didn't play in Rio. His ranking wasn't high enough. Ranked around 100 at the time. So a big jump from him. Ranking edge to Zverev and on the scoreline as well. Serving at 3-2.
Question here for Zverev with what we're seeing is, can he continue to play like this, being this positive in terms of getting inside that baseline, or will he start to feel some nerves as he gets closer to closing out sets if he gets to that point? Such an impressive start though.
Ace number two.
Lose a point when he finds the first serve. Thought about it.
Sometimes the chair pros say, yeah, can you speed it up, please? Thank you. just a rare miss on the forehand from Zverev. And a shorter ball. His brother was giving some great insight in terms of what the day before final might be, might look like. And he was saying ideal would be trying to go to sleep late. Yes, you heard that right. Go to sleep late, but also get up late. Oh, there's the reach from Zverev, but also the ability, the talent.
It's been an area of his game that at times has been criticized at the net. Sometimes looks a little wooden, but that was a stunning first low volley. And then the second, even better, lovely feel, just angling the racket face away. Everything looking good for the German. From Khachanov there, though, just keeping Zverev further back behind the baseline.
And that's something players have done the whole week, going to the towel they need to. After virtually every single point, champions have been very good in terms of giving him that time and not starting the shot clock too early after the previous point. Well, in this game, we talked about the forehand three times. Some errors.
And we talked about the serve as well, and the second serve being confidence and psychological. And again there, for me, just not quite getting the racket head speed. And you just got to wonder here, that's a couple of missed forehands now, so will it stick in the mind?
He missed that also. It was a difficult chance, but it was a chance for Zverev.
Well, for me, the forehand approach here as well, he just played it too conservatively, which I think was all about the previous forehands that he'd missed in this game. And that was what got him in trouble. He was behind the eight ball from there on in. Good hustle from Khachanov.
So really out of nowhere, he has a break chance. Good serve. Into that hip here, couldn't get out of the way, Khachanov.
And if you're Khachanov now, if you can get that serve back in play, you just want to direct the traffic to that forehand wing, test out that confidence.
Oh, look where he struck that forehand. So far behind the baseline.
And you can understand why he said come on to himself there, because I think if you're a German tennis fan, you probably had your heart in your mouth here watching this one land on the baseline. A lot of time to think about it. Well back behind the baseline, has to generate all of his own speed, but hit it with real guile. Got the full swing through as well.
Gets out of it, does Vera for 4-2.
It's a big hold. A bit more encouragement, though, for Khachanov in the game. I think it's to be expected. The way Zverev had started, it was too close to perfect, wasn't it, really? So just showing he is human. But I think that's interesting what you were saying, you know, about his brother saying go to bed late and get up late. You've got to remember, certain tennis players...
He said it to conserve the energy, not try to think too much.
Yeah.
Not try to leave too much time between getting up and the start of the final.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, would have been at an earlier time if they stuck to the original schedule. Play was delayed after these conditions, due to these very, very tricky conditions led by Djokovic and Medvedev, who wanted that done. Understandably.
Mm. And the doctors that they have here as well, incidentally, isn't have some very good sleeping pills. I can tell you this because I've had them myself, and they're like no other. They just knock you out straight away, nice 7 hours sleep, and you're awake again. And so I would have thought he might have taken one of those just to get a nice full amount of sleep.
Are you awake now?
Oh, I haven't had one recently, no. I mean, but I have tried them before. I tell you something, you've got to make sure you're in bed when you have it, though. Otherwise, you could get into some serious trouble.
To pick the right time.
Yeah. But also, you've got to, you know, work out players' body clocks in terms of... I know Andy Murray was always used to talk about the fact he's not really a morning person. He was a late-night person. And so you've got to factor those things in, what suits you.
That might have changed with kids.
Yes, I wonder. And also, it's life on tour. Yeah. As in, you can't dictate when you go to bed, really. Just fractionally stretching for that backhand. And again, you can see his reaction. Zverev knew he was in a really good position there, got himself into the point, got himself up inside the baseline. Big point at 30-all.
Very good depth on the backhand from Khachanov. They traded rockets, and he comes through it from 15-30. Now the latter stage of this opening set. Zverev leading 4-3.
Yeah, I like the reaction at the end of that game from Khachanov as well. Recognising how important that hole was, especially, you know, when he was down 15-30, had that point at 30-all. And as you say, great length on that backhand. As in, kind of feel the backhand exchange, Zverev will favour himself, and I'm sure Khachanov would have been aware of that. He'll be expecting the German to go into his backhand wing a little more often to try and get that exchange going. So when he wins those exchanges, it's got to give him a real confidence boost. And also just saying to his opponent there, yeah, I'm in this. I'm up for this now. I've settled into the final, keeping it to just the one break.
See Zverev going for a racket in his racket bag. Been chatting to some of the coaches this week who said the players really had to tweak their tension, some of them going 8 or 9, 10 pounds higher just to get more of that control with the balls flying, especially the new balls. Every week, virtually, tennis players having to adjust to these conditions, weather.
Yeah, I think, I always think for tennis players, adapting, that's a big word. Can you adapt? You have to adapt to so many different situations, week to week, different surfaces, different temperatures, different times to play. opponents. In the first serve, setting up the point nicely there for Zverev.
And out came the new racket for the new balls. Just off the mark with the backhand. He had the territorial advantage right at the start of the rally before being pushed back.
Yeah, he did just sit a little deep there, Zverev. Something I'm sure he'll be keeping an eye on. Of course, he's had numerous coaches over the last few years, and a lot of them have talked about that, trying to get him tighter to the baseline. Not reverting to that wanting time on the ball. There's nothing wrong with wanting time on the ball, and it's something that we've seen great players do. It's so natural to want that little bit more time. Not to rush yourself. But it's often a fight with the mind. In terms of, it's a natural thing to go, yeah, give me a little bit more time on the ball, but if you step up closer, obviously you can do more damage, you can take time away from your opponent. But it's difficult mentally to force yourself to do it at times.
Nicely done. You can always peel back the layers and say, well, for example, if he gets a shorter ball off the return serve plus one, he could be up on the baseline. And because of the way he hits the forehand, right, there is a bit of a fair amount of spin on it. It's a heavy forehand, so he does need to have a little bit of that time.
Yeah.
Initially, that was a tremendous pickup from Zverev right off the return.
And I think the thing that I think people want to see from Zverev is that how he started this match is in, because he's got those long levers, he has got weapons, and I think sometimes he can get stuck in those long rallies from the back of the court. And when you consider the weapons he has, I think that's the frustration sometimes watching him, not utilizing the weapons to his full capacity. But, I mean, there's just so much to love about his game in terms of the athlete he is, his movement. I think he's underrated in so many areas.
Look at that serve getting up high on Khachanov, but he's standing near the backboard. 5-3.
And so far, so good with that second serve, what we always tend to talk about. Won 6 out of 10, no double faults. Very tidy statistics off the second serve so far.
Khachanov now serving this day in this first set at the Ariake Tennis Park, home to ATP and WTA events. No time to react.
It's a stunner, isn't it? Running full flow. It's a delight to watch. That's the problem. That serve against a lot of other players is probably getting them on the stretch, but instead, with the 6'6", straight in the wheelhouse for Zverev. Look at that with regards to the winner count, 13-3.
Oh, that's some bad luck, but you'll take it if you're a Khachanov.
Any juniors watching, that's why you've got to make your opponent play one extra ball. And I think Zverev just got caught in two minds there. I think he was slightly hesitant whether to let it bounce or to take it out the air on the drive volley. Maybe that was what cost him missing it.
Wow. Well directed with that volley, Khachanov.
That was a sumptuous volley, wasn't it? I mean, coming forward, he was stretching for it. Just great racket head control here. You know, the arms didn't do too much. He didn't try and do too much with the volley either. Beautifully cut underneath it, just guided it up the line and got the depth. And that's something I like to see him do more often, get to the net. I felt when he played his best tennis, when he went and won the Paris Masters back in 2018, that was something he did a lot that week. He got forward, he followed in the weaponry that he has from the back of the court and finished the point off at the net. Hasn't been able to get forward, hasn't really been allowed to get forward all that often in this match. We see, is that a string tension possible change again?
It has to be after he just changed rackets. Well, that matchup they had at the Paris Masters 2018, coming in the quarterfinals 6-1, 6-2 to Khachanov. Seven doubles that day for Zverev. He won 19% of his second serve points. However, he was struggling with his shoulder, had to take a medical timeout in that match. Also a bit of tension between the pair. Zverev at one point thought that Khachanov's camp was a bit too loud and rowdy.
I always feel at the end of the year, particularly the Paris Masters, it obviously had a long year, so it could be a little bit more emotion there. And also you can get a few more injuries like Zverev was struggling with. But it's still a phenomenal win. Anyone in these days to pick up a Masters title with the caliber of players we've had over the last decade and a half.
He's just hanging on to these service games. Khachanov broken once, 15-30 in his previous game. Now deuce. Wow, that was a rocket from Zverev.
Stand and deliver. That is a stunner of a backhand, a Zverev special. Smooth as you like.
What a way to bring up a set point. Turn was phenomenal, and you say credit first off to Khachanov for just getting that ball back in play.
Yeah, and also just guiding it away from the forehand. You could see Zverev wanted to shape up on the forehand, had to switch very late on there. Yeah, digging in, Khachanov.
He's averaging almost 7 points in each of his service games. Khachanov, it just tells you how deep he is going. And he has to go.
Oh.
And this game will continue.
High class tennis. all round. I mean, Khachanov did nothing wrong in this point. He's gone for the inside out there. That's the only danger. Because he was so far off the court, that shot maybe needed to be a little bit better. But the start of the rally was just stunning. And another wonderful backhand winner from Zverev.
Did he make it? He was looking for a call, Zverev.
Yeah, he looks pretty confident that this is missed. Khachanov clearly wanting to get on in the action with the backhands up the line, and it has just missed.
Second set point. No, he missed it. The stretch again from Zverev, beginning on the return. And after taking out Novak Djokovic in the semifinals, he has just carried over that momentum and leads this final by a set, 6-3.
Well, that really was an exceptional set of tennis from the German. I think just showing everyone why he was able to get the better of the world number one and arguably one of the greatest players of all time, because his level was pretty much the same. I think lots were wondering how he would deal with the situation emotionally in this gold medal match, but so far Zverev has played wonderfully well. He's got on the front foot, his court position has been fantastic, he's got forward, and look at those winners, 15-3. That is the big difference. He's the one dictating the play. The second serve has held up as well, zero double faults so far. And this is going to be tough for Karen Khachanov. Khachanov from here, as in, because he's just being dictated in almost every area of the game. He's fought hard, but worrying times really for the world number 25.
He's ready. Ready to go in the second set, and why not? He just wants to keep on going. Sasha Zverev.
And if you had Khachanov here, just tie your shoelace, then tie the other one maybe.
Go for a bathroom break.
He's got to find a way of getting Zverev out of a rhythm. He had that one game where the forehand went off a little, but other than that, pretty flawless from the fourth seed. In terms of variety and what Khachanov can do, not something he's known for in terms of using different shots.
Change the rhythm, change the pace.
Yeah.
Hit a slice here and there.
Yeah. It's not something that he does too often. As I say, maybe just try and get forward, come to the net a little more if he can. Problem for him, though, is he's not getting the opportunity to get up the court.
Well, if he keeps this going, Zverev, he's going to get that gold medal. He'll be the first for Germany on the men's side in the Olympic tennis. And as it stands, he's already going to be the first medalist again on the men's side for Germany since 2000. And Tommy Haas. And that also was a matchup between Germany and a Russian, Evgeny Kafelnikov. Winning there.
Still time to turn it around, as far as Khachanov's concerned. Oh, that is out of this world. Not only the backhand to finish, but the defense was just sensational from Sasha Zverev.
It's a point, a shot that can linger. Maybe mean more than one point.
I mean, Khachanov here threw the kitchen sink at him. I thought he's just going to hit even bigger in this second set, Khachanov, because he's got to change something. And, well, he couldn't have played a better point and yet still loses it. I mean, that is the highest caliber of a point you will see. That's why this guy has been talked up for so long and has won four Masters titles, former world number three. US Open finalist, when he plays that sort of tennis, you expect it won't be too long before he's back in Grand Slam finals as well. And I'm not surprised that point has almost been worth two. It must have rattled Khachanov because he's hit through the ball, hit really big, into the corners, and he still ended up losing the point. And that has got to take an effect to think, what else can I do?
So if he is lacking a little bit in the variety in terms of, you know, changing the rhythm and using his slice, what then else can he do? Does he have to go even bigger earlier in rallies and really up the risk percentage?
Well, I think this has been a criticism towards Khachanov in the past in terms of what is plan B. Which I think is why we saw that sort of losing streak earlier on in the season, particularly on the clay. And then he didn't have a plan B to go to, so when plan A wasn't working, he was just losing matches. I think he's just got to tell himself, you know, he's played some stunning tennis to get here, and he's got to hope that Zverev level drops and not snatch too much or try and play too bold, because that's where suddenly the match can get away from him if he starts making unforced errors like that.
See, he missed that forehand, but that has to be a result of what Zverev is doing and how Zverev is playing. It's 100%. Not just any unforced error. It's because of the way Zverev is playing this match. This is Zverev's time to pounce early in the second. The way he'd been playing, you have expected Zverev to make that return.
Yeah, I mean, he's just picking up no cheap points. That's a real rarity. And he's not even been serving badly, Khachanov. We were talking about the amount of points he's been winning behind the first serve. 65% first serve percentage, but he's only winning 58%. I mean, compared to what he's done in this tournament, that's a lot lower.
Nicely done, especially because he's had some issues on those types of balls in this game on that forehand wing.
Going back to those serving statistics, all of that for me, it's not about Khachanov not hitting his spots. It's about the levers of Zverev and how he's been able to get those returns back and how good a returner the German is. I think in the previous round, a lot of the focus was on Djokovic, understandably so. And I think what was sometimes lost was just what a performance it was from Zverev. I mean, the fact that Djokovic said it as well, he said, look, he wasn't missing the serve. He was giving me no chances. He was taking advantage of me missing my first serve. He was the one hitting the winners. When you've got one of the greatest players of all time saying that, then that shows you how good a performance that was.
Combination of factors, as Djokovic also said, because he said his game really tailed off. Yeah. So put those two things together. Well, he wanted to go big on that forehand, but Zverev can play that patient game for the baseline. He breaks for two love.
And the point that we were just making, and I think that's a classic example. Okay, you look at the rally there, but I look at the first strike from Zverev. That serve hit the center service line. It was, what was it, 189 Ks? Actually, no, it was faster than that. That wasn't right. We haven't got the speed, but that was a big serve, hit the center service line with a bit of cut, and what a return it was. It was within a foot of the baseline. It was like it was nothing to Zverev. And, you know, those points all week have been unreturned for Khachanov. They've been, the points been done by that point. So it's just those subtle things that the return has been sensational from Zverev.
Thud just at the end of the game may have been the Khachanov taking out of the frustration on his racket, hence changing the racket.
You mentioned that win over Djokovic. I just wonder whether Steffi Graf sent him a little text. I mean, of course, fellow German, she's the only player to have done the golden calendar year slam. Well, thanks, fellow German, for making me the only one still.
You know, knowing how I just think that maybe Steffi wouldn't mind. She wouldn't be the type who'd say, oh, I want to keep that. I want to hold on to it. She's so nice.
But it shows you just how hard it is to do. I mean, 15. It would have been an incredible, almost... Yeah, unthinkable achievement. But the fact, you know, Steffi Graf did that, and I'm not sure we'll see it again in our lifetime. It's that tough to do.
It's so difficult. And, you know, winning three in a row, Djokovic was saying that the tank was empty. He came in pretty tired mentally, physically. Well, there he did something different with that forehand. A bit more shape and height.
Yeah, smart play. And that was, I was saying, I didn't want him to go to just hit harder and harder and start making errors. And I like that. I like that play, as you say. Took the pace off, more height, good depth, and just trying to get Zverev out of a rhythm. I haven't seen too many missed backhands like that from the German. So here's a half chance for the 12th seed.
But does he need to break in this game?
I think he'd like to. A set and three love feels like a long way.
It just seems like if he gets this game, Zverev, that that could be it. And his team would certainly want him to break. Khachanov up watching for the stands. So he's involved in the men's and women's side for Russian tennis. Igor Kunitsin and Igor Andreev. He had a huge forehand. Andreev, especially on the clay, so heavy. Didn't really have a serve like that. Not many do, must be said. Served his way out of trouble. Alexander Zverev has been a near flawless performance so far from the German, who now leads by a set and three love.
was slightly tentative on that final volley, but he got away with it. There was a half chance for Khachanov. And right now, if the man representing the Russian... I've forgotten how it is. How do you say it? The
Russian Olympic Committee.
That's the one. He would have felt that he's got to take the half chances now, Khachanov. He can't afford to not take them. Because this guy, I mean, he's just on a roll right now. You hope from a German perspective that he doesn't wake up, someone pinch him and say, you are playing dream tennis in an Olympic Games final. As we see the forehand hit points, Khachanov, as you can see, 51% behind that baseline, but he's being forced far back so often, 2 meters back, 28% of the time. But look at that for Zverev, 40% of his shots are inside the baseline. I mean, throughout the years, this has been a discussion with analysts and coaches about whether he can move up the court more often. And this is why we're saying, and we're seeing Zverev play probably his best tennis we've seen, possibly ever, in this match and in this tournament. And that's one of the reasons why he's getting himself inside the baseline and playing with confidence.
And also getting himself on the front page of the big sports paper in Germany, Bilde, the online version. Looking for a third title this season would be the biggest. After winning in Madrid and also Acapulco. Madrid also where the balls fly. Different because the air is thin. It's thinner at altitude, but the balls do fly there.
Mm. Yeah, and of course being on a clay court, receptive to spin as well. I don't think it's too surprising that we've got two heavy, hard ball strikers in the final here with these conditions, with the balls flying and the receptive courts to spin.
Outstanding, turning the defense into attack, Zverev.
Again, that forehand, you know, most players on tour, they're on the stretch there. It's a defensive forehand, but this is why he's such an amazing athlete. I mentioned Jez Green earlier, no longer with Sasha Zverev, but all that work, that core strength to be able to get him to move to that position, get his balance, and then be able to full rotation through the ball. It's stunning to watch.
Well, it has to be that big, and he has to go so early in the rally and take it on.
And has to be that close to the line just to get it past Zverev. Right close to the line, finally getting the ball past the German.
Was asked to win that point a couple of times, and it was the defending that helped Khachanov.
This is where it's so unfortunate we don't have a packed crowd, isn't it? Because you feel Khachanov needs something special to happen to shift the momentum. Maybe winning a point like that, and winning a point like that would perhaps get the crowd going. You know, they love an underdog here in Japan, so I'm sure they would have been getting up off their feet for that sort of a point.
It's understandable, that frustration from Khachanov.
His second serve's been picked apart, particularly in this set. One from four He's won only 41% throughout the whole match. There wasn't a lot on that second serve.
You can't really argue with that shot selection.
Yeah, I'm with you, Ravi. As in, I just feel, you know, he's trying to punch holes. He's got to hit big. He's got to hit close to the lines. And that will lead to unforced errors. And that ball was there to be hit. My worry is that he goes for that in not the right place. So that's an understandable error. Albeit he won't be happy with it.
That's a great record in finals, Khachanov. Never lost one at the highest level, 4-0. And he's also played in the Youth Olympics.
Yeah, albeit in the doubles with good friend and Andre Rublev, who's in action, of course, today in the mixed doubles final. Oh, no.
Well, is that his best shot today?
I'd actually go with others, but it was still astonishing to watch. I mean, how has he hit this? I mean, look where he is on the court. He's about 4 feet behind the baseline, and boom, within an inch of the baseline. And jumping into that one.
Oh, picked him off. It's all working for Zverev.
And this time I think Khachanov will certainly be kicking himself with that angle. If he was to go up the line, it had to be away from Zverev. I was surprised he went up the line. But still a lot of work to be done from Zverev. Everything he touches right now, though, turns to gold.
And he could be wearing gold in the not-too-distant future. Respite for Khachanov.
Yeah, that's a big point to win. He's hanging on here, isn't he? He's certainly against the ropes. You just never know in this sport. And the amount of times we see matches turn when players have a chance for a double break lead, they have opportunities and don't take them, and then the momentum can shift. This really is where the match is at right now, this game. Tension change, I think, for Zverev. No. Just the towel. Maybe just struggling to grip the racket. And that's something that I think we always forget, isn't how difficult it can be to grip the racket in these conditions, the amount of sweat.
Some players use the powder. Stunning lob from Zverev.
Just a pleasure to watch. It was an awkward ball to deal with. Very low over the net, Khachanov, and he had to hit up the back of the ball. Couldn't hit it with a lot of pace. Really in the mood Zverev is in. You backed him with the lob. Thank you.
And here he is again, having to defend the break point.
Just how smooth was that strike, though? No hesitation whatsoever from Zverev.
3 of 7 on his break points. I was doing something different there. Coming in behind it. Again, leaning into it, crushing it after they lengthy exchange. And no wonder, they're off their feet. Has been brilliant from Zverev, 4-love in the second.
Well, is that the moment? Is that the moment that really he secures gold? I actually didn't think it was a bad point from Khachanov there, as in he was hanging on in it. He found the length a couple of times. But as soon as Zverev had the opportunity to get on the front foot with the backhand, again, another pure strike. There's no hesitation. He's taking the ball on early. He's getting himself up the court. It has just been relentless from the world number 5. And now the gold medal is very much within sight.
And he was the one in that last rally who actually changed the pace with the slice. Now, he can hit the slice better than that because it just floated up a little bit, but he was trying to do something different in that long exchange just to break the rhythm of his opponent. Races out to 40 love. Backed up in a hurry by Sasha Zverev, who is now a game away from taking gold in Tokyo. 5-love.
Well, I know he went to bed late last night, or at least he was told to do that. But I think in those dreams that he might have had, I'm not sure he would have dreamt he would play this well. It's quite unbelievable what we are witnessing in terms of, especially when you consider what happened at the US Open, as in all those demons that might have been there in the back of his mind. And I have to say, how he reacted to losing that US Open final, is in, if you remember that at the end of the year, you know, picked up a couple of titles in Cologne and then also reached the final of the Paris Masters. And I think it would have taken a lot of other players, maybe less mentally tough, to have taken a long time to get over that loss. But I think it's been so positive what we've seen from Zverev since that loss. And we're now seeing it in, well, arguably the biggest final of his life.
His appetite to win matches and keep on playing is very known. It's all about tennis for Zverev. As we look at the average service game duration, tells you just how much under pressure Khachanov has been. Of course, he comes from a tennis family. His dad represented the Soviet Union in the Davis Cup. His mom, he said, coached him. She's also a tennis coach and played. As he was growing up, she was the one who was teaching the technique in his formative years.
Well, we often see, don't we, Ravi, in terms of what age did players start playing? And usually, I'd say the average is about three. But he was one, wasn't it? He had a little racket when he was one rolling a ball around. So he got started earlier than anyone else, just surrounded by it. It's all he's ever known.
Yeah. His mom, she said, took him to the court, obviously, you know, he was in something 4 days old because dad was coaching Misha at the time. So he's always been around tennis and watching these players and growing up. And even that goes for him because the ball was going to be going wide before the change of direction off the net court.
And you can understand Khachanov how he's feeling right now because, you know, he would have fancied his chances having won the last two matches against Zverev coming into this one, but he might not have been expecting his opponent to play this well. First serve percentage will have frustrated him a little bit as well. Starting to drop now. Everything's irritating him. Phone calls are going. I like that play. That's something the future really would love to see Khachanov do a little more often. As I say, that was the sort of play you saw at the Paris Masters, but really, in truth, he just hasn't had this sort of a short ball to be able to get forward all that often.
Third ace. That's for once. He's unable to get to it, Zverev. Getting a warning from the chair umpire. But didn't bat an eyelid. Fully expected that he was going to be coming. And no argument from Khachanov.
Of course, he won't want to be bageled in the Olympic Games final. Desperate to get on the board here. Put a chip and a chair, you never know. These are going to be big moments coming up for Zverev. Got to make sure he asks the question.
But he does get on the board in this second set.
Zverev leads 5 games.
Very well regarded is Khachanov, and he was saying after the semi-final how the win over Karenia Busta is going to do good, really good for him. Working on the mental side of his game, he said, for a while now.
Yeah, likeable guy as well, well-liked around the tour, certainly, as all the Russian players are, to be fair. They've got a real camaraderie between them two.
That's very tightly wound entire week when a ball clips the top of the tape, hit with pace, high and deep it goes. he's missed that as well.
This is what we were saying in the previous game. You know, isn't something he's never done before. So much on the line, it would mean so much to him. And so we've seen nerves from Zverev in the past on the big stage. Unsettling first couple of points. Good news for him, of course, is a double breakup, but I don't want to test the nerves even more. He doesn't hold serve here. Good news for him, though, is that the previous two errors were positive errors for Zverev. It's not like he's backing away. He's still telling himself to do the right thing, do what he's been doing all match. Play front foot tennis.
And maybe the most telltale sign of anything for Zverev, if he is feeling something, would be the double faults. But none of those in this match.
Just been in such a fabulous rhythm all week with regards to that first serve.
Even that works for Zverev. Anticipated well to bring up gold medal point.
Just a bit surprised that Khachanov went for the bunt there rather than the full swing on the forehand. It was a bit of a heavy-handed first volley from Zverev, but it worked out in the end.
Medal to match the color of his chains. Gold for Alexander Zverev. And he becomes the first German man to win singles gold in tennis at the Olympics. A stunning, flawless display against his pal Karen Khachanov. The final score reading 6-3, 6-1.
Flawless, dreamlike, you might say. Khachanov obviously frustrated with how the final went, but I think the big story is how this guy played. He just took the match away from his Russian opponent. And he was terrific from start to finish. We so often talk about Zverev and how he can get stuck behind the baseline sometimes. That wasn't the case today. He got up inside the baseline, he dictated play, he served fantastically well. His returning was out of this world. I mean, there was just nothing wrong with his game. I mean, that was a sensational performance. And if he can keep performing like that on the big stage, well, Grand Slams will follow after this gold medal. But right now, he has just made that special bit of history, and deservedly so. I mean, what a tournament it has been for him.
Outstanding tournament for Zverev, and one of his mentors, Boris Becker, who won gold in doubles alongside Michael Stich at the Olympics, was saying after the semifinal win over Djokovic, bring home the gold. And he's done exactly that, keeping that focus, keeping the momentum, and just, you know, not wavering in this situation.
Yeah, and we wondered whether, you know, having a day off would have put him out of his rhythm. I think we got our answer today. As in, you know, we saw the emotions on the court against Djokovic. You know, he said, "You're the greatest ever player," didn't he, to Djokovic at the net at that time. And he then said after the match it was one of his greatest ever wins. And you wonder sometimes when a player has that big win, can they back it up? Often you get a lull, you get this sort of, they struggle to get going psychologically. But almost today he was better, which I think is even more astounding after that sort of a win. You feel for Karen Khachanov. He's got to tell himself what a great week he's had, though, isn't it? In terms of where he was a couple of months ago, no one would have thought he'd be picking up the silver medal here. And really, today, just outclassed by Zverev. You know, there's areas of his game. Can he learn to get a plan B? Can he add a bit of variation? That's where I think people will be looking for with his match and his game to move forward. Because there's so much to love about what he does do on the court, Khachanov. But to date, Zverev was, well, as close to perfection as I think you'll see on a tennis court.
And you had the contrast, understandably, on the match point. It was similar, actually, to when Pablo Carreño Busta faced his compatriot, Daniel Medvedev. Just joy from Carreño Busta pulling off that win, and Medvedev really taking out his frustrations on his racket. Understandable. You know, the players have talked about it the whole week. You know, not just representing yourself. You're representing your fellow athletes. You're representing your nation. The people watching at home. It does mean so much. Those are look at the final match stats.
Two big stats there for me. Total winners, 27 for Zverev and double faults, zero. And that was helped by, once again, a really high first serve percentage from the German, 69%. That protects the second serve anyway. But the second serve didn't really need any protecting because, you know, he won a lot of points on it anyway. 57% of the points he won behind that second serve. I mean, there wasn't an area of Zverev's game that was poor today. Every area was fabulous. He didn't have to play that many volleys because his ball striking from the back of the court was so big. He just didn't allow Khachanov the opportunity to dictate. And when Khachanov did try and step it up, the movement and the defensive skills of turning the rally on its head was just wonderful to watch from Zverev. And yeah, I mean, that was a delight. I don't know about you, Ravi. I mean, I've just enjoyed watching someone do that on a tennis court, to play to those levels and those heights, and to not be named Nadal, Djokovic, Federer or Murray. I mean, it's great seeing someone else take tennis to that sort of level.
Yeah, Pete, I mean, as much as I think for the neutral, we'd want a, you know, a close final, a gripping final. Sometimes you have to watch matches like this and just say, well, it was a terrific performance, one to admire from the victor. Mm-hmm. And yeah, to come out and produce this in an Olympic final after the win over Djokovic, just too good.
And especially when, you know, he hasn't won a Grand Slam. Yes, he's won the ATP Tour Finals. Yes, he's won four Masters. As in, this, though, is up there. You know, there were so many question marks psychologically going into this match. And you just wonder what that will do to Sasha Zverev moving forward now. As in, getting on the biggest of stages and producing tennis like that. The belief it's got to give him. Yes, he has issues in five sets. I mean, I was talking about a stat to you before this match, and in terms of he's won 16, lost 16 against top five players in three-set matches, won zero, lost seven in five-set matches. So that's something he will have to go and work on with regards to the Grand Slams. But with regards to winning a gold medal, I mean, it's something that when you talk to the players, it's so high on their list. I mean, Djokovic has talked about it all the time, just how much trying to win a gold medal for his nation would mean, how emotional he gets at Olympic Games. And not everyone, Federer hasn't done it in singles, Djokovic hasn't done it, but he can now join the likes of Nadal and Murray to say he has done it, and deservedly so. And he did it, you know, he did it the hard way, beating Djokovic and then winning against Khachanov in the final.
Who had beaten him the previous two times.
Yes.
He's walking off the court with a big smile on his face. Sasha Zverev.
And I'm sure, you know, Khachanov and his team will focus on the positives, certainly, this week. Because there were so many of them in terms of, you know, how he's been serving, how he's been striking the ball. As we see the match point, special moment that he will never, ever forget. As in, we've been waiting for him to win a really big title, either a Grand Slam or a gold medal. You know, he's been talked about since he was 17 years of age. It's taken a little bit longer than perhaps a few thought it would. But he's answered the critics today, no doubt about that.
Yes, he got there. He still did get there. And one of those weeks where nearly everything was working for him. Leading with the serve, and the serve is such an important part of his game. We've talked about the double faults, and there were none of those. So the confidence he's getting, first of all, from the serve, he's carrying it over to his ground game, getting a lot of opportunities straight away via the serve.
I mean, moving ahead, Ravi, to the US Open, I mean, he's now suddenly notched himself up. I mean, we were all talking about Djokovic. Of course, Nadal will be back for the US Open, and everyone's now going to be saying, well, there's three or four. With Medvedev and Tsitsipas involved as well, it's going to be exciting times ahead.
Indeed, indeed.
For this sport.
Well, they came out for the start of this final. Karen Khachanov and Alexander Zverev, the good friends. I know Zverev, as he's done really through the week. Yes, he got off to a slower start against Djokovic when he was down by a set and a break, but he really was on the front foot.
Yeah, straight away. And it was the mindset that he came out with. It wasn't, I want time on the ball to settle. It was, no, I'm going to get up to the baseline. I'm going to take the ball as early as I can. I'm going to be the one to dictate against a fellow opponent who can hit a big ball from the back of the court. He was serving big. I mean, Khachanov didn't hit many winners in that first set, but they had to be this good, that much angle, because getting the ball past the German was nigh on impossible.
That may have been, it may have been the best one of the entire match, although watching at home you can debate whether it was that one or another one, perhaps that huge forehand down the line.
Well, after that one, if you remember, the next point was a double fault from Khachanov, and you just felt he was beginning to think, well, what do I need to do? Because he played a phenomenal point and still lost it. And we saw a number of points that Zverev just stole.
Didn't steal this one. This is how it ended. Yeah. Gold medal point.
Yeah, lovely sporting spirit as well showed by Khachanov. As I say, he's a very popular guy, and these two good friends, lovely embrace to see after what was a really competitive final, but one that was certainly favoured by Zverev. If we look at the stats, 15 winners to 3, and no double faults again in that first set. And, well, there were just so many stats, all of them almost in the area of Zverev. Even though he hit double the amount of unforced errors, that just shows you he was the one dictating the play. There was just the one break point opportunity for Khachanov that he wasn't able to take. You wonder, had he taken that point, it might have been a different story, because that was to break back. Zverev got the second break, incidentally, when Khachanov was serving to stay in the set. Then the second set, I mean, we talk about flawless tennis. 80% first serve percentage, winning 80% of those points. I mean, Khachanov, although he had love 30 in the final service game, I mean, he was struggling to win any points on the Zverev serve all through the set. And 12 winners to 4. Really, I think the frustration for Khachanov will be that the first serve didn't do as much damage as it has done in previous matches. I mean, he only won 46% of the points, and that was including behind the first serve as well as the second serve there. And that was a stat really for him throughout the week that has been so, so high. But for me, that wasn't about Khachanov not serving well and not hitting his spots. It was about Zverev, his reach, and his ability to get those wide serves back, and not only get them back, but get them back with something on it to put Khachanov on the back foot, and that enabled Zverev to dictate from there on in. I mean, can wax lyrical all you like. That was just a wonderful performance to watch from the fourth seed.
Terrific stuff. So 2008, it was Rafael Nadal winning gold, 2012 and 16, Andy Murray, and now Alexander Zverev.
Mesdames et messieurs, la cérémonie des vainqueurs des simples hommes.
Ladies and gentlemen, the victory ceremony for the men's singles.
皆様、ただいまに男子シングルスの表彰式を行います。
Victory ceremony now starting in the men's singles tennis at the Olympics. And there are your medalists. Gold medal winner in the middle, Alexander Zverev, winning the silver for the ROC, Karen Khachanov, and the bronze for Pablo Carreño Busta, who beat this week the world's top two players.
The medals will be presented by
Medal Monteva,
Monsieur
Nena Lalovic,
membre de la Commission Executive, CEO, CIO.
IOC Executive Board Member, Serbia.
IOC, Lizzie, Serbia.
Accompanied by,
続きまして,
Monsieur David Hegarty, President de l'ETF, États-Unis.
ITF President, United States.
国際テニス連盟会長, アメリカ合衆国.
Head of the ITF.
Medal de bronze, España.
Bronze medalist, Spain.
Gold medalist, Spain. Pablo Carreño Busta.
Well, there was no Rafael Nadal on the Spanish team. He talked about wanting to step up Carreño Busta, and boy, did he ever, beating Daniel Medvedev, the world number two, and then in the bronze medal match, Novak Djokovic. And some of the tennis he played in that bronze medal match was just incredible.
Yeah, he's a guy who's had success, of course, at the Slams. But what a moment to become an Olympic medalist. Follows some big names as well from Spain, as well as Rafael Nadal in the singles championship. Sergei Bergara, of course, a medalist back in 1996, won the silver.
And he'll be standing alongside the player that he faced at the US Open last year, the semifinals. And he's actually up two sets on Zverev. Well, we could see the disappointment from Khachanov after the match ended, the gold medal match. But indeed, when the dust settles, he's coming out of the Olympics with a silver medal. He has made it this far, and it has been a great week for him. Not the way he would have wanted to end the week, because he wanted gold, and he'd won the last two against Zverev. But a great week.
Yeah, good to have his moment in the spotlight as well. Of course, fellow countrymen have had the limelight a little more than him recently. What a stunning performance and stunning week it's been.
Gold medalist and Olympic champion, Germany.
金メダリスト, Olympic champion, Deutsch, Alexander Zverev.
The gold medal and the Olympic champion for Alexander Zverev. One match after another, producing brilliant stuff. And of course, the headlines will be beating Djokovic in that semifinal before carrying it over, an emphatic display in the final.
Olympic gold medalists. I'm sure it'll take a while to sink in for Sasha Zverev. But just a quite unreal performance. The level he produced today was just out of this world.
Mesdames et messieurs, l'hymne de l'Allemagne.
Ladies and gentlemen, the anthem of Germany.
皆様, ドイツ国歌の演奏です。
So that's how the final medal standings will look in terms of the men's singles in Tokyo. Pablo Carreño Busta with the bronze, Karen Khachanov with the silver, and Alexander Zverev with the gold. And he was overjoyed when he won the bronze. Carreño Busta, different emotions today for Khachanov. He wanted the gold, but it goes to Alexander Zverev. And when he plays like that, he can beat anybody. Posing for the photos up on the top step Still more medals to be won for the ROC. Guaranteed gold in the mixed final. Two ROC pairs. But the golden moment in Tokyo at these Olympics in men's singles belongs to Alexander Zverev, a winner in straight sets over Karen Khachanov.